style 4X games. So I tend to play a lot of those. A company called Stardock recently released a new edition of their Galactic Civilizations game. I've always been a big fan of that series, so I've been playing that quite a bit. And I try to play as many indie games as I can, studios that are of similar size as my own. Feel like I'm always amazed at the high-quality experiences little tiny teams can deliver. So I've been playing a game called Artisan. And then I also, you know, I also love the throwbacks. Like, I occasionally still play Diablo 2 or Pool of Radiance, like just old, old games, like DOSBox emulators. I was playing Syndicate a couple of days ago, like a Bullfrog game, if you've ever heard of it.
I don't think I have, but I mean, that's awesome, man. I love pulling out my old NES and Super NES and 64, so.
Yeah.
How long have you been gaming? Has it been like since birth kind of thing, or?
I've been gaming almost as long as I can remember, probably more than 20 years. My brother and I grew up really close. You know, we spent a lot of time together, and we played games from the very beginning. I think my first like introduction to video games was watching friends from elementary school play Super Nintendo. We didn't have a console ourselves, so we ended up like as spectators or player two a lot. And I think like looking back on that early experience, I spent a lot of time like observing people playing games and thinking about it more than actually trying to win a game, which I think had some influence on how I thought about video games.
Huh, that's very cool. So you basically got to play you got to be Luigi.
Yes. I don't think I remember playing Mario very often. but I remember watching a lot. I think one of the games that I didn't get to play very often but really loved was Contra.
Okay.
I remember watching Contra a lot and just kind of being amazed at how people mastered these patterns. And later, like, Andrew and I would get some arcade emulator on an Xbox. We had an Xbox and a ton of games, and all we played was Contra.
It's a great game, man. That's classic for sure.
Classic.
So, do you have a favorite game? I mean, I know we like Contra. We just talked about that, but anything? Do you have one that's kind of a go-to, even if it's old?
Yeah, you know, I really love Galactic Civilizations 2. I think that's one of my. That's probably like my favorite go-to game. And it's funny, like I love playing that game. And the first game I actually made and published is called Star Traders, and it's kind of like what I imagine an individual person's experience inside of Galactic Civ would be. Galactic Civ, you play this giant empire, and you set up like trade routes, and you're always ordering around tons of ships. And I always imagined like what would it be like to be like one of those tiny little ships? What was their experience? I would say Galactic Civ, Bard's Tale would be maybe one of my favorite games of all time.
Okay.
It's like an old, old RPG from DOS days. I think I bought it on like 3.5-inch floppy drives when I was like 15.
Nice. Did that get like a re-release or something a couple years back?
Yeah, it did, but it just wasn't the same, dude.
I see.
Bard's Tale was one of those. The original one was so insanely hard. There were sections of the map where it was dark, and you couldn't see anything, so you just had to remember, like, this insanely long series of, like, go north, go east, go south, go west, to get through parts of these dungeons. That was what really stuck with me. It was just the incredible difficulty of the game.
I see.
But I still loved it.
For sure. I was talking with somebody recently, and it was like I think they were talking about Zelda 2 and how difficult it was, and that's what drew them in, was they wanted to complete that challenge. So,
I remember a game called like Revenge, Crescent Hawk's Revenge, that was a mech game. I think that was probably the hardest game I ever played as a kid. My brother and I we were pretty young and probably terrible at the game, but we couldn't beat the first level. And we still played it for months. Like, we probably tried that first level like hundreds of times.
Oh, dude, I know what you're talking about. I used to play a Predator on the NES, and I could not. I have no idea if you can even beat that first level. I don't know if that game was just shipped out because the movie came out or what, but. And I remember I would pump myself up and go, okay, all right, I'm gonna get past this first level. At least I'm gonna see. Nope, never. You could barely jump in that game if I remember correctly. It was like this is a mess, you know.
I remember that game. I also at times questioned, like, does it have a second level, or did they just like make it impossible? And they're like, oh yeah, there's tons of levels. Don't worry.
Oh, that's awesome, man. So. Let's hear a little bit about your current situation and what you're doing.
So my current job is I'm the engineering half of a game studio, principally a studio that's a duo, myself and my brother, and several other contributors. We work with a composer, Infenzia. We've worked with a couple of other artists, Derek Now, who worked on our Pirates artwork. So we're kind of a small group, and right now my responsibilities are game design, game development, technical support. I do most of the testing on the Android and iOS platform, and then I contribute what I can to marketing, go on podcasts and like talk to people in the industry.
Very cool. Let me, and you may have just defined it, but what, when you say engineer, is what, can you define that term, or did you define it by saying you do all of that other stuff?
Yeah, I mean, in my previous jobs, like before I started in game development, I worked as a software engineer, which was a much smaller set of responsibilities. I wrote code all day. I transferred customer requirements into implementation units, so somebody else would figure out what the software needed to do, and they would give it to me, and I would implement it and hand it. So I'd say, like, strictly speaking, that's really what a software engineer is doing. They're converting requirements into code and fixing bugs that or missed requirements. And I found that, like, as a small-time studio, the engineering responsibility is much bigger. I do a lot of what I would say is the requirements gathering, you know, figuring out what's going to be fun, figuring out what we want in the game, figuring out how long it's going to take, and then actually implementing it, the core engineering job. And then after it's released, anything that doesn't work on anybody's device, I end up testing it, figuring out why it doesn't work, and then making a new version of the game that corrects the problem.
I see.
So I would say I'm more engineering. I say I'm the engineering side because my brother does the artwork. But he also writes a lot of code and does a lot of the game design. So I would say that I mostly define myself as an engineer because I don't draw anything at all. Andrew does all the artwork. Like, if you saw my artwork, it would be like stick figures, stars and stuff. So I stay out of the artwork.
I see. So he's like the lead singer. No, sorry.
Yeah. Yeah, man.
He's like the lead singer. You're like the drummer or something.
Yep.
Exactly. Sorry, but I didn't mean to cut you off. The internet cut out there, so please forgive me. So can you tell us about some of the projects that you've worked on?
So the projects that we've worked on, we started with the Android applications, and I really got excited about Android because at the time you could just sign up for Google Play, give them $25, and you were off to the races. Like, you could publish, make games, people would download them. And it was really attractive because at the time, it felt like the devices were fairly low-end. Like, you had the Google phone, and it seemed like we'd have a pretty easy time of making a game with no budget that could play pretty well on that platform. So we started with Android, and we've really branched out. We now do Android and iOS. We do Steam for Mac and PC. The project that people have most likely heard of is called Star Traders. Star Traders is a role-playing game where the player is the captain of a ship, kind of like in the movie Firefly, or I think the movie was Serenity or something, but the Firefly setting where you're an independent captain and you sail around this galaxy like doing trades and staying one step ahead of your enemies and the law that, you know, maybe wants to steal your cargo or whatever. So that's probably our most popular game. Okay. And we've made a couple of other games in that universe. We've got Star Traders 4X, which is a game where you control an entire empire and you're trying to keep your citizens happy and fed and build a fleet of defense ships to ward off the alien threat. And then the first Kickstarter we did, we're a big fan of Kickstarter. We haven't found any, like, institutional investors that wanted to give us money. So Kickstarter has been a way for us to gather investors. And we built a game called Heroes of Steel, which is a fantasy RPG, like Squad Tactics. The player controls four heroes and leads them on this branching adventure through kind of a post-apocalyptic fantasy setting where the world's been destroyed and humanity has fled underground. And these heroes are kind of the first people who make a stand against this darkness and give humanity a chance to reclaim the surface of the Earth.
Okay, and that's what you're kickstarting right now?
We're actually kickstarting a sequel to Star Traders.
Okay.
Star Traders was originally released 4 years ago, and it is starting to show its age. It's still fairly popular, but we've collected so many ideas from our fans and the people who play the game that now seems like a really good time to try and take the setting to the next level and tell another part of the story. So that's what's on Kickstarter today.
Okay. And do you have a link that we can find that, or should I just put it in the show notes?
Yeah, if you search for Star Traders 2 on Kickstarter, it'll come up, and I'll definitely send you a link.
Okay. Very good. Let's I kind of want to backtrack a little bit into your past and kind of talk about, like, what made you choose your profession, and then maybe we can break down the steps that you had to take to get there.
Sure. You know, I think I had a relatively easy choice of my profession. I was fascinated with computers from the first time I saw one, and I knew I wanted to do something with computers. I didn't even really know what it would be, like what a profession would be that used computers, but I knew from the first time I played with one that it was something I would really enjoy. So I didn't really set out to have a profession as a game developer. I set out to be a programmer. And I was, you know, I was excited about making games. I've always been excited about making games, but I don't think I had a perception that games were something I could do as a profession. I made websites and e-commerce applications and business apps for a really long time.
Okay. Okay. And so, what was the transition like, or what lit that fire, or got you moving forward?
Well, like I said, I've been excited about making games, and I tried to make games for a long time. And I think I often tried to make games that were too big. I wanted to make an MMO, or I wanted to make like a really complex fighting game that had all sorts of stuff that was just way outside of my ability to produce, and I would always get frustrated. And I think that's one of the things I learned as a business developer was, you know, companies have people who, you know, as a corporation has to plan to build things they can build. They can't be like, we want to build, you know, a spaceship. If you don't have any idea how to build a spaceship, you're not going to stay in business very long. So I got a lot of experience, like, working on projects that were small enough that they were successful. And I think that really helped me get to Star Traders. Star Traders was, I had an opportunity at work to work on an Android application, but to get onto this team, I had to prove I knew something about Android, and I didn't know anything. So I said, I'm going to go learn Android. I'm not going to do it at work, but I'm going to do it at home at night. And so I said, hey, what can I build that will teach me Android? And so I said, okay, I'm going to build a simple game where you move around a grid and you go into cities and you trade resources. And so that's where Star Trader started, was it was a learning project for me to teach myself Android. And I got it far enough, it was playable, and I was kind of using it with my brothers as like a way to not solve arguments, but like we would place goofy bets on it and both play the game and submit scores. Mm. And a couple of other people were playing it, and someone said, hey, you should really put this on the Android market. It was another guy who actually made Android applications at work, said, it's only $25, you should sign up. Maybe somebody else would like this. And I put it out on the market, and a couple hundred people downloaded it, and I got a whole bunch of ideas. Wasn't necessarily like, this is the best game I've ever played, but it was like, hey, this is not bad. Like, you should do X, you should do Y.
Okay.
And it took off from there. And I think that's what was ultimately was what spurred me into taking it more seriously and pursuing it as a more serious part of my, you know, skill growth, was that that other people were interested and other people had ideas. And I didn't end up getting onto the Android team at work, so I'd kind of built this set of Android skills that I didn't end up using, so I just kept working on the game.
So, for those of us that maybe don't even know where to start, if we wanted to start trying to create something within the Android marketplace, what are the tools, or where do we got to go? What are the first steps in that process?
Well, Android is really unique in that it runs on any platform. Like the development tools will run on your MacBook, your Windows machine. I think you can do it on your Android tablet now. Developers.google.com, I think, is the website. I'll send you like the starting tutorial, and you can put that in the show notes.
Okay.
I think one of the great things about Android is if you don't have an Android, you can probably get one for like $90 or cheaper. Like Swappa.com is a great place to get devices. I have like a foot tall stack of devices. They're all used, beat up, other people's phones I bought, but they let me test the games. So I think that's really great about Android. The tools are free. You can use any operating system. And if you don't have an Android phone already, you can get one pretty easily. And I would say that Google's got some really great tutorials. They've got some games you can download that are finished. Like, you can just download them and run them on your device, and they give you all the source code. Mm. Android's Java programming. So if you haven't done any Java, it might be a bit of a challenge to start there. But there's some really great tools out there for building games without, you know, building mobile games without necessarily going straight into Java. You know, there's PhoneGap is really good. Cocos 2DX has a JavaScript engine that will let you build web games. But I think it depends. If you have some programming experience, pick something that is in the category that you're familiar with. If you're a C# developer, you know, try to build a game in C#. If you're a Java developer, try and build something in Java. And if you haven't built any programs at all, look at a couple of different things, because I found teaching other people development, you never really predict what's going to click for somebody. Java might click for one person, and JavaScript might click for someone else, or C#, you know, might click for a third person. And so I think one of the things people tend to run into trouble is they get recommendations from someone of like, oh, you should use the Android SDK. But it's way better, I think, for someone who's like, hey, I want to make a game, go out, do a search for like free game engines, or HTML game engines, and you'll find a whole bunch. And just spend 10 minutes looking at each one, download the sample code, and something in there is gonna click.
Okay. And something like that, I mean, what at that point, when you download those engines, you just got to kind of add the artwork to them?
Yeah, you know, I think you want to... I think the thing is, there's so much out there. There's sample games you can get, and there's a ton of great places like GameAssets.com, free game assets. I built Star Traders, the original one, with no artwork I created at all. It was all stuff I found online where people were like, hey, I made this artwork, somebody make a game with it.
Okay.
And I ultimately ended up replacing all of it as the game evolved, but it let me see my work and it let me build something people could play. Mm-hmm. So I think one of the things that people who want to get into game development should do is stop trying to make everything perfect on the first release and start making a game.
Okay.
You know, and that's what slowed me down was I wanted to make an MMO, I wanted to make a fighting game with mechs and robots and physics. And I think, you know, my advice to somebody would be make a game. Even if it's a game that is so simple, you can explain it to somebody in 2 minutes, make it. You're going to learn so much. And your next game will be way better, and the third game after that. And before you know it, you're going to be at the point where you can make that fighting game with robots.
Sure. So it's just a matter of taking the, and this has been like, this is like the third or fourth show I've recorded so far, and it's been a theme. It's just been take imperfect action. Like, do whatever you can and get started. But I do want to just follow up with that, with the last little question there. So if somebody does want to get into like the programming side of stuff, should they pick one programming language and start to focus learning that to start out, or should they just jump right into these free game engines and stuff, or maybe do a little of both?
I would say a little bit of both. I would definitely be careful to, if you want to get into the development side of it, be careful not to get pulled into a game engine where it's abstracted everything away, where you're just dragging and dropping shapes onto the screen and you're using an editor. I think one of the risks there is the game engine's writing a bunch of code for you and it's holding you back from learning. Maybe you're getting to a polished product faster, but take imperfect action. Yeah, writing the code yourself, it's not going to be as smooth as maybe something that does it all for you visually, but you're going to learn a lot more. And I think the key thing is just don't get frustrated with yourself and accept the fact that it's a learning process. So I would recommend that people do something that gives them a chance to really connect with the code. They're writing it or they're modifying it. And I can't stress enough how much my personal learning about game development came from downloading stuff off of GitHub or off of Google Code samples and playing it and being like, hey, I wonder if I could like do X with this. And a lot of that stuff, you know, once you get into it and you start taking it apart and trying to change it, you learn a lot about why it's set up the way it's set up and how it works internally.
And it sounds to me a little bit too like it's kind of like picking up a musical instrument for the first time. Like, you don't just pick it up and start jamming, right? If you're grabbing a guitar, you've got to play that thing. The best way to learn it is to play it for at least 20 minutes a day, every day, and not to just, if you try to jam that whole section of time into one day, like, I'm only going to practice Saturday, but I'm going to do it for 140 minutes or whatever, you're still not going to get the best out of it. It sounds like this may be the same kind of thing where you need to be doing it daily, even if it's only for 10 or 15 minutes, just to start getting used to seeing code and getting a feel for it. Am I correct?
Yeah, I think that's a great analogy. And I think, you know, I think that's a good way to think about it, because if you've got experience learning the guitar, you can even imagine it, you wouldn't say, I'm gonna practice 20 minutes a day for a week, and then I'm going to give a concert, you know. And if you do, that concert's not going to be great, but it's going to be a performance piece that you worked on. Mm-hmm. So I think that's a really good analogy. You're never going to play, you know, really incredible riffs after a week of practice. But you are going to have learned something. A friend of mine was learning to play the guitar a few years ago, And one of the things his teacher had him do, she said, you need to record every week this piece. And so every week he recorded a piece that he played over and over, and then he would listen to it from weeks previous, and you could hear just in this, you know, 2-minute piece the incredible progression he was making. And I think at times he felt like he wasn't learning anything. But then you would go back and you would hear him play this, you know, this set of music, and it was obvious that he was really moving.
So let me ask you, because it's just like we're talking about, like with guitar or anything that we're trying to learn, the best way I feel to learn something is to have a path set out before you, to where today is like tutorial one, and tomorrow is tutorial two, and the next day is, or, you know, it may not be the next day or whatever the case is, but here's lesson one. Get this stuff figured out, then move to lesson two. Do you know of any resources or websites or even books or anything that would break something like that down for learning a coding language?
Yeah, I think especially on the iOS, like the Mac and iPad, iPhone stuff, there's a great place, Ray Wenderlich. He's kind of an icon in the game development tutorial space. He has really step-by-step, hey, let's make Angry Birds or Angry Pigs or whatever, mm-hmm. and it's step one, and it's really like it's 10 tutorials or something, but it's like we're going to get the basic project set up and we're going to show a background, and then we're going to take that project you built in the first tutorial and we're going to add the pigs, and then we're going to do, you know, we're going to do this, He works with a lot of other people in the industry to write the tutorials, and he edits them and gets them together so that it's a progression. And when I was first learning about, like, coding AI, I used a lot of his tutorials because they'd be like, here's how to set up a basic AI agent that avoids running into things on the map, and it moves around. And sometimes when you're not really deeply familiar with the subject, it can be really intimidating. You're like, I don't even know where I'd start to build a bunch of artificial agents that can chase the player around a map. But if you, mm-hmm. you know, you get a good tutorial and the author knows their stuff, they can break it down into easily digestible chunks. You want an agent that chases the player? Step one, you need the agent to be able to avoid the walls. So we're going to teach an agent to avoid the walls. And then, you know, it needs to have a goal. So we'll tutorial two, making it move somewhere. Tutorial three, what if that target location moves? What does the agent do then? And he's got a great set of tutorials on all sorts of different kinds of games, from things like Angry Birds or Endless Runners or role-playing games even. So I'll send you that link as well.
That's great, dude. The reason I ask, because, I mean, I know a lot of people could just Google this stuff, right? But I know how Google works, and I know how, like, SEO and internet marketers work, and you will find a lot of things that rank for number one in Google are there because they're trying to sell a product, and they know how to game the system. And so even Googling stuff sometimes isn't the best anymore because you're like, I got to search through 10 pages to find something I'm looking for that isn't somebody trying to sell me an ebook.
Oh, yeah. Know? Oh, so true, dude. The number of people out there who are like, I've got the ebook that will get you to number one on the market is incredible.
Yes.
I do. I think a lot of the stuff that, like, you asked me about and, like, my answer, a lot of that comes from Twitter. You know, I follow a lot of game developers who I follow not because they have ebooks, but because they have games I've played and I've liked.
Sure.
And, you know, when you say, like, hey, game devs, how do I do this? A lot of them will be like, you know, if anybody says, hey, buy my ebook, unfollow. But you're right. Like, people who are doing it, we're all reading tutorials. And they are very hard to find on Google because there's so much noise out there. And there's so many people who are like, hey, put your email address in and I'll send you X. And what they send you is an invitation to give them $10. And there's nothing wrong with that, but if you do that, if you Google it, you're going to end up signing up for so many things, get spammed, and not get any tutorials.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think one of the things going on right now is, like, there's all these people who are pushing to bring programming education to the online community. Khan Academy, Udacity, like, there's small online universities that are really trying to make programming more accessible. And a lot of them are using game development as a way to do it because game development is so attractive to children.
Mm-hmm.
You can't sit a kid down and be like, hey, we're going to build a shopping cart. It's going to be amazing. We're going to do an address book and, like, shipping calculators. Kids are like, I don't want to do that. That's stupid.
Right.
But if you're like, hey, we're going to build, you know, we're going to build a game, people are like, oh, I love games. And I play games all the time. Let's do this. And suddenly this JavaScript, you know, programming language is just a gateway to making fun stuff happen on screen, and people pick it up.
Yeah, dude, that's great. I mean, I think I talked about it in my last episode a little bit, but I mean, it was like $90,000 at the Seattle Art Institute for a game degree, a gaming degree in gaming, and no. I mean, I could buy a house and forget it. It's too much. But so, kind of speaking of schooling, what did you end up doing for schooling or training?
You know, training, I wrote a lot of code. I graduated from high school, and I took a job at a startup. And I'm not sure it's the path I would recommend. I missed a lot of, like, fun stuff that I think my friends experienced going to college. But I think it also somewhat, for me, I learn best by doing stuff. The lessons I've learned failing. Failing to complete a project or failing to finish a functional unit. And I've learned a lot from those experiences. And I have, written millions of lines of code in my life, and I learned most of it just by reading and trying to do stuff. And I've had some great mentors, people who are willing to take me under their wing and help me learn. But I unfortunately missed out on the $90,000 in student loans.
Yeah, so. I wouldn't say unfortunately. I wouldn't say unfortunately at all. I mean, the thing is, like, I know a guy who managed GameStop, and he had a degree in, like, communications or something, but he had zero experience working in communications, so his degree really didn't help him at all as far as getting a job. And then once he lost that job, he ended up at home Office Depot making copies for people. So his degree didn't do him a lick of good. And the hands-on training, I mean, sometimes it's just where it's at.
I got to go, like, a couple of years ago, we were thinking about shutting the studio down, and Andrew and I both, we went to a bunch of interviews. And I interviewed with some big-name game studios in San Francisco and Silicon Valley, you know, Disney and various other mobile outfits, and none of them were like, oh, you don't have a college degree? Get out. You know, they were like, okay, that's fine. What have you made?
Right.
You know, and, you know, I showed them Star Traders, and when you put Star Traders next to, like, Where's My Water? Come on. You know, Where's My Water is polished and beautiful, and it has a million sound effects. Mm-hmm. Star Traders is clunky, and it doesn't have great sound effects. But I was able to talk to them about why I did the things I did, and the budget I had. You know, they got it. Like, you're going to talk to game developers that have a $6 million a game budget, and you're like, I built this game for $600.
Right.
They're like, that's not as good as our games. Get out. They're going to go, you know, you're going to have a conversation with them as equals where they're going to say, so why did you make the decisions you made? How you spent your money, like, be it $6 million or $600, what was the thought process? And being able to sit down with men and women in the industry and say, yeah, I've made games. Yeah, they don't have a budget. They don't have slick graphics, but I understand the gameplay decisions I made goes a long way towards, you know, towards making them understand that you have the skills they need in their company.
Yeah. It's really important just to get to start building that portfolio right now, no matter where you're at.
Yeah, and, absolutely.
You know, and getting a website, getting that up, and getting a place to show off that stuff, too, is important as well. This is always a fun question. What were some of the mistakes you made along the way, if you don't mind?
Yeah. You know, I think in the game development space, one of the biggest early on in our studio's growth, we made a pretty big mistake, and it ended up with me going to these interviews and us thinking about shutting the studio down. We let some trolls pressure us into changing our course. You know, there will always be people who want to see you fail, and if they have lawyers who write nasty letters, it can be really scary. So I think one of the biggest mistakes we made was letting people intimidate us just because we were small and inexperienced. And anyone in that situation who's gotten a demand letter from someone, my advice would be to listen to your own heart and don't let patent trolls or copyright trolls convince you they own anything you're doing, because they're almost certainly liars. And I think that would be, if I looked back on the studio, the history of our studio, the biggest mistake we made was listening to people who weren't our fans. Listening to people who wanted to shut us down because we were too close to something they wanted to own, and they didn't like it. And I think that that was a real sad time for us. I think we compromised where we shouldn't have, and I wish we had done it differently. We waited too long to make another game after Star Traders. And I think occasionally we've released games before they were really ready. Some of our games, Andrew and I were like, this game's really fun. The market's going to understand it's unfinished. And I think there's like a tipping point, right? Like, you need to make games to gain experience, but there's a certain point, like, for us, after we quit our jobs and we're paying the bills with games, you do have to step up the level of polish. And you've got to think about what people are willing to accept and what they're not willing to accept. So I know that kind of runs counter to what I was saying earlier, but I think you've got to understand when you've made that transition. And I think a lot of it has to do, like, I don't have a different job. Like, I'm paying all my bills with game development. And that was one of the scariest times for me, was the, like, 6 months after I quit my full-time job. I was like, I'm a game developer. It was terrifying. looking back, I sort of wish I had done it earlier. I feel like we would have been able to capitalize on our opportunities a lot more. But it was really scary, and I didn't know if it was a good idea at the time. So
that's a huge decision. That's,
yep.
That's not something that comes lightly. So you said you've had some mentors and stuff. What's the best advice you've ever received?
You know, I think the best advice I've received was probably from a friend of mine, Sean, you know, who said, you probably don't know as much as you think you know. and that always seems to hold true for me. Anytime I look back on the things I thought I was an expert in 3 years ago, I'm like, I didn't know anything about anything.
Yeah.
And being okay with that is really critical. I think, you know, I have 20 years of experience as a developer, and I still hold very, you know, very strongly to the concept that I don't know as much as I think I know. And there's always more to learn. Some people spin it as like there's always somebody smarter than you. Yeah, but they have a lot to learn too. There's everybody has so much more growing to do. And I think the best advice, you know, the way Sean put it was that you've got to be okay with that. You've got to listen to people who are ahead of you and behind you in the experience, because everybody has something to contribute. And I would say the other piece of advice is make allies with everyone you can. Every person who reaches out to you, even if it's negative, you know, don't be proud and take, you know, take their advice, take their criticism, take the brutal, horrible things they said about you and learn from it. Mm-hmm. One of the things I do that a lot of game studios don't do is I use my personal email address for our customer support address on Google Play. So if you're on Google Play and you click email this developer or you click the support button in our games, you send an email directly to my personal address.
Yeah,
which
that's good.
It can be tough. You know, people are like, I hate you. I hate this game. It, you know, this game is terrible. Why did you even make this? And I rub everybody back. I even write the people that are like, I hate you back. And I ask them why. You know, what could I have done that would have made you love me? And sometimes those people respond and they're like, oh, I didn't realize anyone read this email. And then we'll have a conversation where I learn something really valuable. And they say, you know, they tell me something that I didn't expect to hear and that helps me improve the game or the support or the experience or even, like, how I responded to them. So I think it's really easy to be like, that person's a jerk and I don't have anything to learn from them. But, you know, as a game developer, it's you're in the you're out there with people who are just trying to have fun, and they may not take it too seriously. But if you do, you can learn a lot from them.
Yeah, dude. I mean, that's such a great way to deal with just trolls and haters and stuff, is just to really find out, like, hey, what is your problem? Like, what is it that's bothering you so much? Because there may be a lesson there. If they're just jerks, there's nothing you can learn from that. But if they actually are like, well, actually, this is the reason, well, hey, let's talk about that. Let's address it, if it's worth talking about. But a lot of times you can shut them down. You may even gain a fan from it.
Yep. You know, and if they respond to the email and they're like, no, seriously, I really hate you. I want you to die. That's what Google email filters are for. And you're like, okay, like, I've tried 3 times, and I'll do that. I'll give people 3 shots, and if they're, you know, offensive or they're refusing to engage, then you just filter them. And there's nothing wrong with that. Like, you didn't ignore that first email. And I think especially when you're new in the game development sphere, so many people, they assume you're a giant company or that you don't care. And you're right. You can earn fans. People are like, I didn't like this game, but I love your attitude.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and if I were you, here's what I would change about your game, and a light bulb goes off, and you say, I never thought about that. That is the best idea. And 3 months later, you're getting 2 emails a day being like, I love this thing. This new thing you added is great. And you're like, you know what? I got that from someone that started out a conversation with, I hate you.
I love it. I love it. So I think this next question is going to end up kind of summarizing this entire show. And maybe not. But what would you tell 18-year-old Corey if he walked up and said, hey, I want to get into the game industry. What should I do?
Yeah, I would sit 18-year-old Corey down. First thing I would say is, like, don't smoke so many cigarettes, buddy. Slow down.
Excellent. All right.
And the second thing I would say is start making games now. Don't try to make the biggest, most complex game you can imagine. But make something playable and play it, get your friends to play it, show it to people you don't know, and incorporate the feedback. And above all else, dude, don't be scared to fail. Failure is the first step on the path to really learning.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I think when I was 18, it was a lot harder to get a game published. You know, you could make a game, but there wasn't Google Play. There wasn't a lot of things that today make it easy to get a game out to hundreds or thousands of people. But I would still have the same advice. You know, don't be scared to fail, because the games you're making, people want to play. You know, and not everyone has the passion for making games, there's always going to be more people that want to play games than want to make them. So there's, you know, there's a real opportunity there. If your passion is to make something, go make it. Insanely simple. I've been talking to a young lady who's working on a game, and her original plan was to make Final Fantasy V, right? Huge branching storyline, all this stuff. And after we talked about it, she kind of settled on, I'm just going to make the part of Final Fantasy V that I really loved, which is the combat system. I'm going to strip all that other stuff off, and I'm going to work on a game that's just the fighting part. And suddenly she's starting to make progress. You know, she's doing a lot of stuff that before she just gotten bogged down in, like, I'm going to need all these different pieces of code and all this different art and all these different designs. But that's going to take 2 years to get it done. And by the time you get done, you're going to be exhausted, and no one will have told you you're doing a good job, that they love your game, and no one will have given you ideas. So, you know, I think the best thing to do is take the idea you have and find a part of it that can stand on its own and make that into a game and show it to people. And understand that people will love the game they're playing. They don't know that you wanted to make an MMO. You know, they don't, you know, they just know what they're seeing and they know it's fun.
Yeah. That's great, man. Well, I got to thank you for taking the time to come on the show, man. This has been great. I think we connected yesterday on Twitter for the first time. That's the first time we had any interaction together. And, you know, here we are less than 24 hours later. So I really appreciate it.
Yeah, I really appreciate you taking the time. And the questions you asked today were really cool. I liked the direction your podcast goes. I think it's something that people can benefit from because there is so much opportunity to create and distribute works that you're passionate about today. And I applaud you for putting together something that's really focused on helping people of all ages and you know, skill levels get involved with something that they're excited about.
Yeah, well, man, I thank you. And it's good for me to hear that, because it's like I want to make sure that this is something that's going to help people. I mean, I want it to be fun. I want to laugh like we did, but I also want to make sure it adds value. So, Corey, what's the best way for somebody to connect with you?
I love Twitter. Corey Tracy at Twitter. That's a great place to reach me. I'm also available on Gmail, corey.tracy@gmail.com. Like I said, I respond to every email. But that's probably the best way, email or Twitter. I'm really active on Twitter, and if you've got any questions that fit in 140 characters, I'm always available to answer stuff.
Okay, very cool. And we will have all the links that you talked about in the show notes so that anybody that's interested in checking that stuff out will be able to, especially your Kickstarter and everything. Tell us the name of that game one more time, just so if people want to search right away.
Star Traders 2.
Star Traders 2. All right, man. Well, hey, I do just appreciate you taking the time, and maybe you come back after that thing releases and we can hear about how it went.
Absolutely. I'd love to come back sometime.
All right, man. You take it easy.
You take it easy. Thank you.
Okay, and all of the show notes for this episode, if you're watching it on YouTube here, you can find down in the comments below. So make sure to check those out too.